So I won't forget that. We'll try to keep it pretty efficient. I'm Mike Miller from Cloudant. I'm going to be talking about, will transactions kill NoSQL? Before we start, well, A, you can guess what I'm going to say, maybe, since I'm a NoSQL vendor. But I'm going to try to give you a little bit of a little bit of history about how we ended up where we are, some personal projections and also company projections about directions that the market's going, but then overall some reasons to realize that maybe we're not trying to solve exactly the same problems that transactional databases were built to solve. So I'd love for this to be as interactive as possible. So if you have questions, just shout them out. Like, if I don't notice you, don't be afraid to interrupt me, and I'll repeat them for the camera. So before we start, can I just get a feel, who's a developer in here? Like, who writes code on a daily basis and commits more than once a day? Okay. Who's more in kind of business or management overall? I see some hands going up more than once. you know, those folks who didn't raise their hand for anything, like you.
I'm a student.
A student, great. Where are you a student?
Belgium,
cool. OK, so this is not a bad place to learn. Any other demographics that I failed to represent? How many people use NoSQL on a daily basis, one form or another? OK, and how many of you are interested in learning about it? OK, great. So this I'll try to talk a little bit about some history and kind of how we got here as we go through. But the idea here is, like, there's been a lot of activity in the field. I'm going to highlight some of it in the places where I'd really emphasize that, you know, it's worth going to learn yourself by reading some papers. I'm an academic guy in my own background. I got to this, without going into detail, this is a picture of the Large Hadron Collider where I worked last. I came to this very pragmatically. Okay, so I did big science, and we had, you know, the world's biggest data problem. And we did not have solutions that we could buy from vendors. So point blank, we had to invent our own stuff for file systems, for distributed computing, for data synchronization over 200 data centers globally. So I'm a pragmatist. I don't come to this steeped in, you know, the long philosophy of SQL and relational databases. So I hope you find that approach a little bit fresh. But as an entrepreneur, I came to this, and this is just kind of my one big high-level slide, realized that big data was breaking our model of computing, right? So the way we would build a stack, the way we would architect something, whether it's an application or whether it's analytics, those things just weren't scaling to meet the needs. And at the same time, the world was getting very distributed, right? The way people build applications, the way they generate data, the way they consume it, suddenly it's all over the place. And the technology we're using really kind of assumes that you still have a global write master for your database, okay? And that doesn't seem very relevant anymore when you have people that are distributed all over the globe, and they have a finite 200 milliseconds before they're completely bored and shut off your app if you don't serve, you know, a page load for them. So it's clear that these two things have really, you know, inspired a lot of innovation, I think, over the last 5 years. I'm going to talk about that a little bit. But the cool thing is it's a market, right? And the market has responses. Things are floating to the top, right, as winning ideas that help solve some of these new problems. And I think NoSQL is one of those big ones. I think cloud is another big one. I think there are other innovations to come. But, you know, the great thing is that these solve specific problems, right? It's easy to point at NoSQL and say, okay, people come to it for scale, right, or speed, or low latency, or durability, or something like that. And cloud is also, if you listen to, the Netflix presentation today, you know, if you are in the land grab, this is a huge, huge, right, advantage that you can just get things going very quickly, right? And so these are a small set of the market responses that, you know, we are actually part of with my company. This is a company I work for. Cloudant is a distributed database as a service. The one neat thing, if I have it on here, is it's the first database that ships with a mobile strategy. Okay, so it has thoughts of what, you know, type of devices are going to be connecting to it and putting data into it and getting data out of it. It's kind of built from the ground up to be actually, you can't see it, but distributed all over the globe. Okay, and that's something that we're going to talk about. And those are some of the things that make transactions particularly challenging. So before we jump into kind of the meat of the question of whether or not transactions will kill NoSQL, I just want to kind of take a run through through how we got here. Did you have a question or no? Okay. So I'm going to show you a picture on the next slide. Go ahead and guess what it is, right? If I had to show you one picture, that would motivate the entire cloud and NoSQL market. Any guesses what it would be?
Oracle.
Oracle? Yeah. Not a bad one. You mean like the Oracle from Delphi? Or you mean, okay, those guys in red. All right.
Three towers.
What else do we have?
Yeah.
That's not a bad one. I like people that's a good one. That's close. I like I like people who build things and create things. And I like people who are pragmatic.
Oh, a big giant ERP with like 6,000 tables.
Close, actually. I've got one of those. This is my personal take. These guys. Anybody know who this is? I shouldn't. Yeah, this is Jeff Dean from Google, right? And Sanjay Gemwan. These guys are foundational. They are all over the place. I started my company out of MIT because I stumbled on some of their work, right? And it was so incredible. It was just, I stumbled on one paper and it solved all the problems I had building the CERN data center. And then I stumbled on the next one. And I kept following the line. I was like, these guys are just so far ahead of us, right? They were publishing things in 2004 that were already outdated for Google, right? Because they had already kind of moved on. But there's a great article which I had the joy to contribute to, talking about kind of the academic roots of, you know, Bell Labs to Xerox PARC to Google, and some of the work that these fellows did, and they continue to not disappoint. And it's really fun too, because there's some great stuff pulled from Google about like an April Fool's Day joke, you know, like, what was it? Jeff Dean once compiled his code to check for errors in the compiler, you know, things like that, pretty entertaining. But if you take a look at, you know, you know, the speed of light used to be 3 × 10^12 meters per second until Jeff Dean optimized physics. You know, things like that. But you see exactly what I mean if you read some of their work. And so, you know, this is really, in my mind, the canon of 3 or 4 papers that defined the ecosystem that brings us all to this show. Okay, I can trace this back to like 3 or 4 papers. The first, which was really transformative, which was Google File System. How do you build a very cheap, highly distributed file system that's pragmatic in its ability to redundantly store your data? And if a node dies that stores some data, you just throw it away, right? Instead of trying to keep everything online all the time, you can do this. And, you know, this thing was running in production, I'm sure, by 2004. It's already been replaced with something called Colossus, which is not yet fully published, right? We are just getting a poor man's knockoff of this called the Hadoop file system, which we're all running now ourselves, and it's inferior to what existed 10 years ago within Google, and I would stake my name on that. Companies like MapR are starting to bring some of this technology back out. But really, at the core, you've got to find a way to store the data, right? Huge amounts of data within one data center or between data centers. So that's, you know, I've helped build distributed file systems, 2 custom ones that, as long as nothing ever broke, were awesome. But the minute something broke, they fell over, right? And that's the huge difference. This was built from a very different mindset. The next was how you actually analyze data once it's on there. And this is a seminal paper about Google MapReduce. And people, you know, MapReduce is an old algorithm. It's an old design pattern. But there was a point in this paper which was just like the eureka moment for me, where they show sequential C++ code, right? I'd done distributed computing for a decade and a half at that point in science, where as a first-day grad student, you launch, you know, 100,000 jobs that run on the data computing grid all over the globe, and you analyze petabytes of data and you get results back. That part wasn't crazy, but you had to do all the scatter, gather, and scripting yourself. Right, you know, we bought really expensive tools like Platform LSF, you know, from finance that would do that, but every single person had to know how to do that scatter gather computing. And Google MapReduce was like, oh wait, you don't have to, right? All you have to do is tell me what you want to do with one line of a file, and I'm going to take care of everything else, all the fault tolerance. And that's really neat. And they actually show you something that we still haven't quite gotten back to, which is thinking of embedding within a sequential program a whole bunch of distributed computing. So they have a sequential C++ program that goes down, and then you realize that one of these lines that runs, you know, essentially what's a query or does like a word count example, which is actually going out and, you know, launching 10,000 jobs to run over a petabyte of data and doing all of that condensing back for you. So the idea of like bringing together sequential and distributed computing, or procedural and distributed computing in one thing, is something that we're still working on. Next was Google Bigtable, how you take these primitives, you know, to store and analyze data and then turn them into something that looks like a database but at an incredible scale. And then finally, one that snuck in from Amazon, which was had a ton of operational data in it. The concepts from Amazon's Dynamo paper themselves were not new, right? This stems from work done by Robert Morris, the inventor of the internet worm, who, I don't know, at 15, Robert Morris Jr., at 15 or so, I think, he invented the first internet worm, briefly went on the lam, turned himself in, maybe went to jail and then got tenure at MIT. Somewhere in the middle, he started ViaWeb with Paul Graham and got very wealthy. He runs distributed systems now at MIT. But the idea is some peer-to-peer stuff here about how you build redundant, robust systems, distributed systems, that look semi-transactional, okay? And we're gonna get into that in more detail. But this one is really cool because it showed that, you know, it's not just like neat ideas. This thing is like running Amazon shopping cart, you know, when you get down to it. And that operational data was amazing. So this is what I call kind of the old canon, which I think is really interesting. There's a new canon that goes with it, which I can talk about over beers after this, you know, where you see like what they're doing next. But this, you know, what did this inspire? Well, I stumbled upon this first, this stuff after seeing this Business Week article. My girlfriend's mom over Christmas, when I was back in Michigan, like slapped down this magazine in front of me. She said, "Lots of computers, big data centers, all over the place. Sounds like what you do." And I was like, I read it, and I was like, "This is exactly what I do." I just didn't know what it was called, right? And it was called cloud computing. It was called Wisdom of the Clouds. He went on to found Cloudera. They're doing reasonably well. Out of those papers, we ended up with Hadoop, with Storm, and we ended up with all of NoSQL, right? Cassandra, CouchDB, MongoDB, React, et cetera. I think all of those are traced directly out of the problems that we have and the recipes that existed, you know, in literature, especially some formative ones. So the people at the root of all of these companies, you know those papers inside and out. So if you're new to the field of NoSQL, I encourage you to go read. They're incredibly readable, right? That's another great thing about the work by Jeff and Sanjay. So then a funny thing happened, right? We created the stuff. We created, Hadoop. We created kind of the analytics and batch analytics, you know, the data analytics, data warehousing, batch analytics side, and then the kind of OLTP side of things, right? Which are databases, and you know, this happened around 2008. It started beginning 2009. NoSQL was kind of phrased, you know, or that name came about one of the first conferences, and now it's turned into an actual serious industry, and there are conferences like this one that go into it in a lot of detail. But the interesting thing is, while these were coming to market, there was another slug of innovation, which kind of goes by the NewSQL name of things. And so, you know, this really kicked off with another paper by those same gentlemen called Megastore. This is the SQL-based distributed database that backs a lot of Google App Engine. Okay. That was a really interesting paper that made the word Paxos, you know, jump out in everybody's mind, which is something I'll talk about. And then there are commercial versions of this. VoltDB came out of the Stonebreaker side. This is Jim Starkey's NeoDB. The FoundationDB folks are doing something very similar, which are trying to make SQL engine scale and bring, you know, make sure that you have atomic single row operations and multi-part transactions. These are neat. They have their drawbacks. Google Spanner blows everything out of the water. Okay, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit more. This is the one that dropped somewhere in 2012. It had been hinted at for 3 or 4 years at conferences. Jeff Dean and Sanjay Gemwater worked on it. And they basically showed that how you could build a SQL database with multi-part transactions that was truly globally distributed. It's an incredible piece of work that I'll talk about a little bit. But before we get there, you know, when we talk about transactions, I think it's worth taking a look at how we ended up in, or why we ended up in exactly the place that we are, which is we have people writing applications or doing analytics with data stores that are sometimes eventually consistent and often don't support multi-part transactions. So, like, why the heck would you do that in the first place? Well, here's a kind picture, right? Some of the things that you give up are schemas, but what you gain is flexibility, right? And this is really the story of the web. Schemas are great if you have the luxury to sit down and predefine everything, right? But oftentimes you don't, right? Oftentimes, just like we heard from the Netflix speaker, you've got to move, right? And you have data sources that are new, you have data sources that are changing, and you have to be able to adapt to that. And if you're coming at it from kind of the enterprise side, from a data integration standpoint, schemas are actually the thing that seem to most hinder data integration, right? You think if everybody just agrees up front, then you can all play your data together, but nobody ever agrees up front, okay? It's just an absolutely unsolved problem. So the incredible thing about being schema optional, if you will, is that you can put all of your data into a NoSQL database or into Hadoop, you know, and just the file system, HDFS, and then you can start to read it and say, hey, give me a document or give me a row of that file, and if it has these properties, I'm gonna treat it like a duck, right? And if it has these properties, I'm going to treat it like a dog, and I can apply that type of schema on read. Okay? So from an analytics standpoint or a data integration standpoint, that's a huge thing that you've gained at the sacrifice of having to declare schemas up front. Schemas are actually very handy, and I'm going to talk about that later, especially with respect to Google Spanner. The next thing, really, which people don't actually talk about much because we're starting to take it for granted, is manual sharding. Okay? Sharding by itself is not a dirty word. It just means that you're going to take your data and you're going to distribute it over more than one machine, right? Over more than one file, and those files can be on different machines. Now, there's a painful way to do it, which is that you do it in your application. So if I'm writing a Yellow Pages application, right, and I say, okay, I'm going to put all the A through M's on this, you know, MySQL server, and all the N's through Z's on this MySQL server, that's a logical thing to do. But that puts all the effort of maintaining that sharding onto the developer, into the application tier. And that's tough, and that's actually exactly what Google did. This is a quote from the Spanner paper where they're talking about the F1 ad network. So it's like a relatively small database, a few terabytes, but it is like their number one revenue generator, right? It's how they do ad targeting and ad display. So they had a sharded MySQL service, and then the trick is when you want to add more machines, right? When your data grows too much for the way you sharded it, now you've got to take the A through M's and turn that into like A through F, F through something, something through Z, through M. When they did that last resharding of that F1 ad network, and these are this, you know, 30 incredible Google engineers, it took over 2 years, right? That is an incredibly risky time to be running your application while you're doing that, right? If you're making mistakes during that period, you've just taken on a huge amount of technical debt. So manual sharding by itself is not an awesome thing, right? But what you get is auto sharding, right? I'm sorry, I don't have a nice picture to go with it. But you know, if you use CloudInt, if you use something like React or any of these Dynamo-inspired systems, they take care of distributing your data for you on machines and on disk so that you don't have to think about how you're actually going to represent it, right? So that's something that NoSQL has given developers, which is absolutely huge. And if you're a business owner, you know, you're owning some portion of a product, that's something that you really want to pay attention to. So manual sharding is really easy to get off the ground, but it is incredible technical debt going forward. Something else that we've given up in moving to NoSQL largely is locks, okay? A lot of the systems, with the exception of Mongo, are lockless, right? So React is lockless, CloudInt, Apache CouchDB, absolutely lockless, Cassandra is relatively lockless. That means that when you have a large number of concurrent users, right, you're not going to have somebody who's doing something outside of the scope of your application blocking what you want to do. Right? And the classic things are like, if I want to update a document or I want to delete a document, that better not lock the whole database. If it does, you're really in trouble, right? And if it doesn't, you have this kind of smooth sailing road. You have to think a little bit differently, and there's some sacrifices, right? Locks make things easy, right? That's why they were introduced. It allows you to make sure that everything is fully consistent at every point in time. But I think that the general better approach is to block like optionally, okay? To make it something that a developer can do if they say, this absolutely has to block everything else because it's a very special operation. And you know, you can do that on reads, but not on writes. And so that's a statement about the CAP theorem about availability over consistency, right? And so if you follow a Dynamo-inspired system, you know, that means something very specific in the quorum algebras, which I can talk about over beers at a whiteboard. But I think this is really nice to allow people to write data and then to apply their own consistency requirements on reads, okay? It's just like we did with schema. Schemas are optional, and we can apply them on read, but we don't necessarily have to apply them on write. That makes it easy to build applications. We sacrifice tables, right? And we've picked up data exchange formats that are much more natural for the web, okay? So SQL is great, but it's really poorly matched for JSON. You know, Postgres allows you to store JSON in it, but it's very tough to interrogate it because JSON is, you know, it's what applications trade on the wire, right? And a lot of the time that traffic goes over HTTP. And SQL interfaces are just not meant to do that. So if you ever find yourself trying to write a SQL query or build a declarative, you know, SQL-like language on top of a highly nested rich data structure like JSON, it's really gnarly. And eventually, like, man, I would just kill for one line of Python, right? Like, and so the general model is, okay, take your one line of Python or your one line of JavaScript, push it up to the server, right? And it's going to give you a document or a row one at a time. And it's a much more natural way to, it's essentially like a stored procedure. Right? All the NoSQL databases kind of differ in what that stored procedure is going to do. But generally, you're going to want to upload some code that interrogates your rich data structures and then pulls a small portion of the data out to maybe index or send, you know, into an analytics report or something like that. Okay? And finally, the biggest thing here is that when you're running distributed systems, you can't have single points of failure. And that's a very typical problem with traditional relational database management systems. And they're getting better. And the new SQL papers really go into how you can do that. But the huge thing, and this is especially, I think, obvious if you read the Google File System paper, if you go back and look at the original roots of Dynamo, these are really like self-healing systems, okay? If you're running these things at scale, and I mean, how many of you are running distributed systems yourself in-house? Okay, one or two? It's hard. There's an awesome article by Jay Kreps, one of the lead architects at LinkedIn. And even though Amazon's, you know, our number one competition, he's dead on when he's like, here's why you should use Amazon. Because they write the software and they run the software. And these systems are too new, the failure modes are too exotic, and the scale we're talking about is too big for the typical, you know, the typical operations team to run them successfully. And I think that's absolutely true. It's the number one reason that we don't package our software and give it to other people to run. It's just, you know, it's moving too quickly, the scale is too large, and the failure modes in distributed systems are pretty intense. So the software is written to be healing, right? But it's challenging still. I don't want to give any false impressions. All right, so kind of next question on this path is, before I talk about what I think is going to happen is, you know, I think a lot of people assume some things that are false about systems in the real world that are transactional and or immediately consistent. So let's just take a little step back. Let me also pause here and take a drink of water. You guys have questions on this path stuff? What about the history? Question? No? All right, everybody's tired in here. There's a lot more energy in the room yesterday. All right, so let's step back and talk about whether or not we need transactions. All right, so if I was to choose one example of an eventually consistent system, what would I choose?
A bank.
A bank? All right, that's my number two example.
Amazon?
Writing
books.
Yes, that is eventually consistent. They even talk about that in the Dynamo paper, how you can end up with duplicates in failure scenarios. Yeah? Yeah, that's true. That actually makes my point. One more? Nothing? All right, here's my example. The truth. This happened the first time I gave this talk. It actually happened on that exact day. Do you guys remember when the AP Twitter account was hacked? It said, you know, White House, bomb explodes at the White House, Obama's hurt, right? And it took about 10 minutes for the world to realize that wasn't true, right? Anybody else notice what happened in that 10 minutes? Market dropped like $10 billion, right? It took a pretty significant hit of like a few percent. So like this is the next George Clooney, Matt Damon, like caper movie, right? You hack somebody's Twitter account, you manipulate the truth, and in the time that it takes for the truth to anneal, right, for it to come back to the real value, right, the recovery time, you can actually make a lot of money in that time if you wanted to, right? So think about it like a hack. Somebody hacks the account, it's an impulse into the system, right? They're ready to trade, they buy at the right time, they sell at the right time. Make an incredible amount of money. But the trick is the truth is actually eventually consistent, and if you follow politics, it probably never converges. Okay? Right? Nobody ever actually agrees on what happens. Bank accounts at least seem to converge. Right? And so in my mind, what really matters is the convergence time. Right? This one actually turned out to be more like 10 minutes. There was a lot of money made and lost in those 10 minutes, which is, you know, makes me almost want to quit and run a hedge fund. But banks are the next obvious example. So, you know, when I talk to most developers, they always say, well, I want it to be like my bank. Right? And I would say, but your bank is the ultimate eventually consistent system. Right? If I'm you know, wiring money around, you know, between continents, it is not immediately consistent. And when I'm using an ATM, it is absolutely not immediately consistent. And you can see the bank's logic in the rules they set up because they know it's not immediately consistent. So when you write a check, right, you can give that to somebody else and you know, they will put in an ATM, the ATM will immediately give you money back, right? And the check, it turns out, doesn't even have to be valid. I had a roommate in college that we were headed out for a weekend, and on a Friday he stopped by the ATM, and he's like, I don't have the money, but I'm going to get paid on Monday. So he wrote that on a piece of paper, put an envelope, put it in for $500, got $500 back out, you know, his daily limit, and went on his happy way. Monday, his account was shut down. He didn't go to jail, you know. But it takes them a while to figure out that it's not immediately consistent. And so what happens, right? Banks have... they set up penalties, they set up maximum amounts of money that you can pull out, and they have a hedge strategy if somebody actually, you know, frauds the system, right? So you can get out at most $500 a day, right, unless you actually hack ATMs hard ways. So that's what? That's 500 times 300 days a year, right? You can, their maximum exposure is actually incredibly small, right? And so in building systems, you know, that are eventually consistent, these are the types of things you have to think about as a developer, which is if two people order the same book at the same time and they're globally distributed, what's the penalty for being wrong? We send an email to one customer. It's probably okay, right? That's probably okay. And there are solutions when you build NoSQL databases, there are data modeling techniques. You know, Nathan talked about this this morning. You know, the number one thing that you see people do is move to an immutable data model. And this is exactly what I mean. Imagine you're modeling a bank account or, you know, an account with currencies in a game, right? And somebody gives you $10, you know, in real money. You turn that into bank currency in the game. Well, one way to do that is you have a single document or a single row in your HBase or Cassandra table, however you want to think about it, that stores the balance, right? And you're just updating that from all over the place. Well, that's one way to do it. But then what happens if, you know, one of those transactions dies on the wire, right? Or how do you know that that is immediately reflected throughout the whole system if it's globally distributed? Well, there's another way to do it, which is actually the way bank accounting works, which is immutable documents that just represent a single transaction at a point in time, not the changing state of account balances, okay? So here's an example where you have a document in JSON. Natural construction is you give things a type, right? So this documents of this type will be treated as transactions. They have a source account, they have a target account, and the amount and say the currency of this. So this is like a transaction log, if you will, right? And then you have the time of this. So you have kind of a write-only state machine, okay? And then the state is calculated by using secondary indexes, right? That gives you the account balance. So you can write one of these transaction documents and then do a query, right, at the same time to say, okay, what is the account balance? And if something goes wrong, it's eventually going to percolate through the system. And the time scale of how eventual is usually on the order of, you know, tens of milliseconds to a second, okay, in most reasonably connected systems. What really happens is network partitions. And this is very robust to network partitions, because if you reconnect your system, eventually this thing's going to percolate through everywhere. Okay? But again, you have to think about the cost of being wrong. Okay, so let's take a look at Google Spanner, because that's another piece of the puzzle that we have to get through here. I think I'm doing okay on time. We started at 4:15, right? Okay, cool. Okay, so I just want to draw your attention to a few things from the Google Spanner paper here. So it's a scalable, multi-version, globally distributed, and synchronously replicated database. How many people actually are exposed to it, read the paper, or taken a look at any of the blog write-ups? About half. This is a really cool thing, okay? This is what will be talked about at this conference in product form in a few years. That's my personal take. And Google's working on turning this into a product. Right, so it's the first system to distribute, to globally distribute data and give you externally consistent distributed transactions, right? So that means data centers all over the globe, multi-part transactions. It's really the, the analog from very forward-thinking SQL-based engineers to what's happening in NoSQL. It's a really great contrast. And I think the truth lies somewhere in the middle. The really cool thing about this, I'm actually going to talk about it because it shows you how hard this is. I sat through the last talk from FoundationDB, and I think they glossed over a few of the really hard points. And I hope this, you know, looking at what Google had to do, helps you understand just how challenging this problem is. But the real heart of this was a novel time API that exposes clock uncertainty. And I'm going to talk about it in detail. But the upshot is here, it gives you non-blocking reads in the past, lock-free read-only transactions, and a topping schema changes. Okay, these are really big things, and they're the types of things that DBAs and developers love because it makes their reasoning very simple and straightforward. Real quick, a little bit about how it works. The idea behind Spanner or any distributed transactional system is you've got to have the ability to put things in a line, right? If I get a whole bunch of requests, I somehow have to agree upon the order in which they come in and then be able to like repeat that order in other places. That's the really hard part. So the natural thing is you just look at the system time, right? But distributed time turns out to be very hard. And in fact, to solve this distributed time problem, the Google engineers had to use GPS and then a somewhat orthogonal system, which are atomic clocks, okay, in their data centers. So this is like very non-trivial. Atomic clocks aren't super expensive, but they're still not cheap. Okay, and you can get them in a rack. And if anybody wants to think about, this is millisecond scale synchronization. I think I worked out nanosecond scale synchronization. All I need is a neutrino beam. So see me afterwards if you're interested in the patent. But really, the idea is they said, okay, if distributed time is hard and you can never keep everything in line, then let's do our best to keep things synchronized, but let's measure how out of sync the system is. Okay, and let's expose that as like a 95% confidence level in the time. And just reason a little bit probabilistically, okay? And if our synchronization between everything gets worse, then we'll just slow the system down, right? Because you can deal with that. And that was very, very novel, but very challenging. And so they they have a mix of things also that have to make the system unspoofable, because if you can spoof GPS from the outside, having atomic clocks inside is much better. But these things have low frequency drift, so you have to kind of and their signals with this. So it's really cool, and this is what it looks like. This shows you the uncertainty in time, you know, versus day of the month or something that the spanner system exposes. And this shows you kind of everybody agrees within, you know, 90% of the system agrees. That's well below a millisecond. By the time you get to 99.9, you know, three nines of agreement, you're sitting around a few milliseconds. Okay, so it means that over hundreds of thousands of machines, you know, even with the world's best technology, you can actually only synchronize time on the order of milliseconds with this technology. Okay, that's pretty interesting. You could probably go farther, but this was good enough for them actually. And then there are things where they lose one of the masters and it goes up. And in these periods where the uncertainty, right, in this time API goes up, then the system has to naturally slow down. So this sets basically a rate, if you will, for how many transactions per second the system can do at a fine level of granularity. So as the skew rises, the transaction rate slows. That was one of the interesting things they did. But this is a very kind of novel and pragmatic approach that allows them to do multi-part transactions and have the system be externally consistent, which is a very big deal when you're writing these applications. So it's very cool. So those are the two building blocks, I think, to talk about how we got here and some of the reasons that we did it. Whether or not transactions, just to kind of whet your appetite about whether or not you really need them in the first place. And then let's talk about what reality is really going to hold. So here's my take on how we should view consistency in multi-part transactions. I think consistency should be like strong consistency, say single document, strong consistency on disk, should be like the four-wheel drive button on your car, okay? There, the multitude of operations you want to do as a developer don't require it. They just don't. You may think they do because you haven't sat down to think about the problem enough, but they generally come with things like some locking or some extra slowdown. In a dynamo-based system, I'm not going to go into the details, there's an incredible link here by some folks at Berkeley, Hellerstein and others, who talked about, well, what does eventually consistent really mean? Like in a system like, you know, React or you know, CloudEnt or Cassandra, you know, is it minutes? Is it hours? Is it seconds? And the reality is it's usually milliseconds, okay? And so you have to think about, all right, if I'm more than that time scale, if I'm changing things, if I care about consistency on the order of a second, then that's fine for me, right? Because I'm 1,000 times slower than a millisecond. If I care about consistency in time scales less than a millisecond, then it's a big deal for me, right? And so there's a way for you to evaluate, you know, they have a little, you know, they have an analytic formulation, they have a Monte Carlo that they got from real world data, they have some little JavaScript tools for you to kind of reason about this. But the point is, okay, say I have a counter, right? Just as a concrete example, I have a counter that I want to update from a big distributed concurrent system. Well, if I'm updating it once an hour, that's probably going to be fine, right? I could use a dynamo-like system to do that. That's eventually consistent. But if I'm updating it, you know, once a microsecond, then I'm going to be in a whole world of hurt, right? Because it's never going to catch up. So the question you have to ask yourself is like, okay, what's the time scale of my operations, right? In order for me to be able to understand that. And this is kind of the rule if you're using a Dynamo-inspired system, which is in the backbone of the majority of NoSQL device technologies. You know, and you can do things like make sure you make things immediately consistent on disk already within Dynamo-inspired systems. So you can get 90% of the way to strong consistency on disk just using the parameters available within a Dynamo-like API. That's great, but there are some asterisks on this. And the asterisks come from concurrent paths into the system, okay? The fact that most NoSQL systems that are based on Dynamo don't do the Google Spanner thing where you make everything get in one funnel and get in line, right? You just accept things in a lockless manner, right? Spanner locks, right? It does fine granularity locking, right? Row level locking. And you know, Megastore itself has locking and is actually very slow. It's incredibly slow. But things are immediately consistent. But developers liked it. They could reason about it. And that was one of the reasons that it was like so popular, right? So there's some asterisks in Dynamo systems, but it already goes a long way. But I think what you'll see is that, you know, I think we should treat strong consistency per document as four-wheel drive. And I think that, you know, the market knows how to do this. You know, you can do it with generalized Paxos. We're working on it. I know the React guys are working on it. I'm not sure what Cassandra is doing, but it's in the product pipeline. Simply put, it's not the most requested feature. That's where it is. It's like SQL. Declarative languages, people ask for it, but it's not the most requested feature yet, right? So it's something that's going to be coming down the path. Let's take a look at what the Spanner folks say. They say one of the reasons that they wrote the paper, or they did this work, was they thought it was better to have the application programmers deal with performance bottlenecks, okay, on writes or updates due to overuse of transactions, instead of having to always code around the lack of transactions. And they say, okay, we know how to do transactions, two-phase commit over multi-Paxos mitigates the availability problem. That just says there's engineering and algorithms that you can throw at that. We know how to solve that problem, but there's some trade-offs. But their main point here is that, coming from the kind of NewSQL side, it's like, well, maybe we went a little too far. Like, let's just go back to transactions being the default. Then developers find it easy to reason, and you can go back to writing applications, and we'll just deal with the slowdowns as they happen. And that's actually not bad for the specific problem that Spanner was built to solve, right? Which was their ad network. A traditional three-tier application where you've got clients, running in browser someplace, you've got complete control over the app tier, and you've got the database right underneath that. Traditional three-tier app stack. But that's not where we are, and I'll get to that. In my mind, transactions are like, strong consistency of documents is four-wheel drive, transactions are like this optional, this button, the lock the differential button. I recently learned that my car doesn't have this. I have a Honda CR-V. And when I high-centered it over a log 25 miles from the nearest cell phone tower at a trailhead with just my wife on a very cold and snowy day, she pointed out that it would have been a really good idea to have this button, right? She's a great... great woman, though, and helped me like stack up rocks under the tires so we could get out of there. It was either that or kind of snowshoe a marathon distance out. So this is something you only use in case of emergency, right? That's the way I look. And I think that's the way as developers we should look at multi-part transactions. These are possible over multi-Paxos using two-phase commit. And again, it's one of those things that you're going to see coming out of NoSQL, right? NoSQL devices. But again, it's even farther down the line. And developers, even people that are running huge amounts of real money through systems, millions of dollars a day through either e-commerce sites or Amazon, right, or through things like mobile gaming, like very aggressive mobile games, have learned to reason in terms of that immutable data model and thinking about what's the penalty to being wrong and how long can I be wrong for, right? Because there are trade-offs in the other direction. And the big reason here is this, right? When you talk about traditional databases, when you talk about Google Spanner, you're talking about systems that are by default highly connected and only occasionally become network partitioned, okay, where they fall out of sync with each other. But I would argue that there's a whole another exploding ecosystem around mobile devices, right, that we all use, and we all expect these things to work even if we don't have Wi-Fi, right? Who uses Expensify? I mean, it's the best app ever, right? Changes your life, and you do not have to be connected to take a picture of a receipt, right, and have it sync later on. How the hell did it do that, right? It did it. It would not work. You could not use Expensify on a plane if it did immediate, strong, consistent multi-part transactions. It just wouldn't work. It would say, sorry, can't do it, can't be satisfied. And the reality is that mobile is in a chronic state of network partition. This is it, right? And so the systems that we need to solve this problem are very different, right, than the just kind of a scale up of traditional SQL databases. And so I know this isn't a mobile-based conference, but really, you just can't ignore what's happening over here in this side of the market, right? It's changing everything. This is not crazy talk, right? This is exactly what we sell at CloudEnt. Our competitors are trying to do similar things. You want to be able to write to your local data, your local data store, which is like local store, maybe into the browser, and then synchronize back and forth to the cloud at a later point in time. And it's absolutely real, right? We have customers that do it. Parse is doing incredible things with it. This idea is here now. It's like HTML5. We used to argue about it in 2008, like it would never come. And now we just all use it, right? And so the same type of thing, being able to synchronize data across different device types that may or may not be connected to the internet is really important, right? And if you look at the explosion of internet-connected devices and where we are with like distributed data gathering, like how many of you have a Fitbit? Right? We're going to have all these different things on us that are gathering data all the time. We're going to need systems that can deal with partitioned networks. So getting just to nail it home, I don't think transactions are going to kill NoSQL. Right, and I think that mobile has already killed transactions. That's really, that's my takeaway here. And what you need in reality is systems that can be adaptive, right? The default should not be multi-part transactions. You know, NoSQL will evolve. I think that you should expect evolution in late 2013 and see people bringing strong consistency to market in 2014. Maybe multi-part transactions by the end of the year. But again, they're just not the most demanded feature. These things are going to be options, right? And there's going to be have to be a little bit of a different thinking as you move into kind of the bell curve of enterprise developers that maybe I don't always need this. Like, what is this strong consistency or this blocking transaction really buying me in this case? And that's a little bit of education that has to happen. And so with that, I will take a couple questions and we can all go get a drink. Thanks.
So yeah. What you say is great, but there are some things that as a company you need to think about, right? Like for example, your financial. If you are doing, if a company is to report out their financial, that you cannot say, hey, you know what, I want it to be rented, right? That, am I selling 5 million, or am I selling 4 million, or am I selling 5 million, right? So it's really based on the use case, right? And the use case is you really do not want to do to use NoSQL to say that, okay, you know what, I'm going to base it on, I'm going to use it to report out on my financial. The same thing whereby you talk about mobile, right? Like my son, he takes pictures, then later it's synced up with the Wi-Fi, right? Mm-hmm. But just think about if you are putting in your check, right? Because mm-hmm. banks can check, and if he says wait for tomorrow, because it's not
yeah.
late, you're like, I'm going to kill it, I've overdrawn by $500.
Yeah.
So it's really based on use case rather than based on what I think directly it should be.
Yeah, so I guess it's more of a comment than anything, because I was just asked to repeat it. But I think you're right. You need to understand the situation you're in and whether or not the problem you're solving requires immediate consistency or multi-part transactions. My response to that would be, again, you talked about, you were able to sit down and in those situations say, what is the time scale to strong consistency, right? Can I be wrong for a second? A lot of times, I think the answer is yes, right? And you're not necessarily wrong. You're just seeing time move a little bit slower, right? Things propagate through the system. It's not like you're going backwards. One thing I have learned is it's got to be monotonic. Data can never go backwards in time, right? You just completely screw up developers if you do that. So that doesn't make sense. And that's actually very challenging in a distributed system, right? Monotonicity. But it doesn't. You don't need serialization to be monotonic, and that's a great thing. Yeah, absolutely. It's a use case thing. And I think that if nothing else, like NoSQL as a movement has kind of just like raised the question again, like, okay, maybe I should sit down and think about that, before we get rolling. But I think that there are a lot of other things you get, right, by being lockless, by being able to deal, it's very challenging to build a system that's fully versioned and has, hash histories associated with every document and all of that overhead, but it allows you to reconcile two causally disconnected things later on in time. And that's very powerful. I mean, that is what, the NoSQL vendors, that's what Basho is working on before they're working on transactions, right? It's same thing, we put all of our effort into that because we think that sync is just, more important at this point and more of a differentiator, more of an enabling technology to people building new applications than transactions. One more question? Yeah.
Yeah. Two people bidding in an auction on eBay. It decides which bid comes in before the auction ends.
True.
So it arbitrates.
Yeah, and first of all, I hope you understand that this is meant to be a little bit inflammatory, right, to raise some interest in the use of kill. Yeah, I don't think mobile has killed relational databases. And yeah, I was using transaction in very specific, you know, database terminology, which is multi-part transaction, you know, which usually means two-phase commit, right? And the point is that these transactions are definitely getting more distributed in time, right? They have a little bit of a state change on a device, then they have another state change in the cloud, right? And we need to build systems that make that very easy for developers to use, right? Instead of having to build that synchronization themselves and build the storage on local state themselves. I mean, we could build our own computers. We could build our own sync, right, if we wanted to. And some folks like Parse have kind of done that. They've built their own sync. Parse, Convey, these back-end providers. But I think that the database, you know, NoSQL database technology isn't making it far easier by changing the fundamental way we're representing that data on disk to enable us to synchronize that later on, and then do it in a way that will enable, I guess, some more transactional integrity in the cloud. So I agree with you. It's not as clean as yes, no, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, yeah. Absolutely, absolutely.
You can't lock myself on saying I'm synchronizing weight.
Yeah.
So it has to be, there's no asynchronity. I mean,
yeah.
Transaction as a word, I'm with you. That said, we have a very strict definition of what that is. That's unit of work consistency. Things have to be done.
Yeah.
So it's an overlapping proposition. Whether it's single or distributed, doesn't matter. So I think we have relaxed.
I agree with that, and you said something else that I think is really big, which I didn't get a chance to talk about. But very technically, the way we store data on disk to enable that sync, right, is changing, right? So you're going to see all the NoSQL vendors moving, you know, away from just Merkle trees and vector clocks to hash histories, which give you some history of this document's different versions. And in, you know, the phone and the cloud can synchronize and say, I have a portion of this part of the hash history. You have this portion of the hash history. These three leaves from here need to go over there, and these two leaves from here need to go over there, and now we're synced. And there's a very quantitative measurement of what sync means, right? And if conflicts arise in that process, like two people ordered, you know, or two people simultaneously in a disconnected way operated on the same document, then we can't throw that data away. We need to expose it in a consumable way for the developer to resolve that conflict. In the case of, you know, the Amazon's original example of that, two people, you know, or you double order something, two things show up in your shopping cart, they expose that back to the consumer and let them kick out the duplicate, right? But I think we need to do much better with being able to push your conflict resolution strategies into the system and have it auto-resolve those for you.
Well, there's event sourcing. Event sourcing, yeah, has given us the semantics where we can, as long as you store that it happened, you can resolve it. That's why banks operate. You know, they keep track of everything that's happened, good or bad, minuses and pluses, and then they resolve. That's why they turn it into a hugely profitable model in bank fees and penalties. They make an enormous amount of money off of eventual consumers.
That's true. All right, I'm over time, so I'm going to stick around. Thank you, guys.